Hello students, welcome to EPG Pathshala. I'm Dr. Himanshu Arora from Department of Anthropology, University of Delhi. Today we are going to study a module titled Multiple Pathologies and Geriatric Care in India from the paper Biosocial Gerontology. First of all, let's start with the learning objectives of the module. After going through this module, you'll be able to know about the concepts and definitions of gerontology. You'll learn the various age-related pathophysiology which are common in elderly. You'll able to understand the management, prevention and care for aged people, and you'll be able to learn the status of geriatric care in India. Now, we'll give you a glimpse of the topic through a brief introduction. Gerontology is the study of the biological, social, psychological processes of aging. Biological aging refers to the physical changes such as hearing loss, declining vision, accumulation of fat, and decline of muscle mass, which affects the efficiency of human body. Psychological aging refers to the changes that take place in sensory and perceptual processes such as loss of memory, learning, intelligence, skills, and motivation to learn are anticipated to decline. Social aging is the study of changing roles and relationships of an individual with the society, which includes values, roles, and norms that are culturally concomitant with a particular chronological age. The population of the aged is rising throughout the world, due to which concern and care for them have attracted global attention of the social scientists and governments. In India, the population of elderly in the year 2021 will be 137 million. India is the second largest population of elderly in the world. Now we'll talk about aging and its associated pathologies. Elder people are facing potential consequences of the aging processes, even though most people reach old age in reasonable health, due to progressive loss of function, frailty, and diseases. By age of 60, the risk of disability arises from age-related losses in hearing, seeing, and moving, and non-communicable diseases including heart disease, stroke, chronic respiratory disorders, cancer, and dementia. Alzheimer's disease. Alzheimer's disease is a degenerative brain disease. It is a global health burden among the elder in the developing countries. Alzheimer's disease is an irreversible and progressive deterioration of the brain characterized by memory loss, disorientation, depression, and deterioration of bodily function. The onset of the disorder is insidious and more common with increasing age, which usually occurs after the age of 65. However, Alzheimer patient may manifest progressive cognitive and emotional changes as early as the 5th or 6th decade of life. Some of the early symptoms includes depression and apathy, difficulty remembering recent conversations, names or events, misplacing things, and losing the ability to retrace steps, withdrawal from work or social activities, challenges in planning or solving problems, etc. Decline in mental alertness, adaptability, sociability, untidy, agitated, and self-centered attitude are some other associated symptoms. Later symptoms include memory failure, gradual deterioration of cognitive abilities, personality and behavior deterioration, impaired communication, confusion, poor judgment, and ultimately, difficulty in speaking, swallowing, and walking. The exact cause of Alzheimer's disease is unknown, but its pathophysiology is related to the injury and death of neurons initiating in the hippocampus brain region that is involved with the memory and learning, then leads to ultimate entire brain. These changes are eventually accompanied by the damage and death of neurons. The hallmark pathologies of Alzheimer's disease are the abnormal aggregation of the protein inside neuron an accumulation of beta amyloid outside the neurons. Some suggested causes are strokes, high free radicals, biochemical deficiencies of certain enzymes, and chromosomal defect. In some of the studies, it has been pointed out that Alzheimer's disease is the primary cause of dementia. Risk factors for Alzheimer's disease include age, genetics, mild cognitive impairment, cardiovascular diseases, and traumatic brain injury. Health promotion and management. Addressing the environmental factors, education of care providers, revisiting past and current medical illness, defining target symptoms involves the most efficacious approaches to various abnormalities in Alzheimer's patient. Also, use of behavioral management, avoidance of toxicity, establishment of psychiatric diagnosis can be done. In early stage of brain disorder, neuropsychological testing is also helpful for differentiating cognitive deficits of Alzheimer's disease from other dementias, as well as deficits associated with other neurological and psychological disorders. It is necessary to assess living environment of patients so as to identify and maintain abilities and things an individual is able to identify. Healthcare providers should periodically discuss safety issues such as medication, management, wandering, fall risk, driving, and environmental hazards. Along with regular health maintenance and checkups, monitoring of disease progression and therapy are very much essential. Monitoring of other medical conditions that may indicate the presence of other comorbid disease state is equally important. Now, coronary heart disease. Coronary heart disease is a condition of impairment of heart function due to obstructive changes of one or more of the coronary arteries causing inadequate supply of blood to the heart muscles. Chronic coronary artery disease is most commonly due to obstruction of the coronary arteries, which in turn usually results from atherosclerosis. Pathological lesion leading to coronary heart disease is called atherosclerosis, defined by accumulation of complex carbohydrates and lipids in the blood vessels. Chest discomfort is the predominant symptom. Angina pectoris is a discomfort in the chest or adjacent areas. Accumulation of complex carbohydrates and lipids in the blood vessel leads to thickening of the arterial vessels of the body in cerebral, abdominal, and peripheral circulation, and thus interferes with the oxygen supply to the heart muscles. Most patients with unstable angina have sequence of myocardial ischemia. Due to reduction of coronary sinus oxygen saturation and later blood pressure or heart rate may arise. It has now become a major global burden in public health among developing countries due to its increasing prevalence, affecting approximately about 1/3 of urban South Asians. Among all ethnic groups, Asian Indians have an increased prevalence of metabolic syndrome. Risks for developing cardiovascular disease increase with increasing age, and the highest rates for the 65 to 74 year age group is reported. The major risk factor among the elderly include hypertension, dyslipidemia, impaired glucose tolerance, physical indolence, and cigarette smoking. Cardiovascular diseases are the leading cause of illness, disability, and death among the population aged 65 and older. Management programs. It is important to initiate disease management programs for elderly with cardiovascular disease in order to provide proper treatment plan or medication and self-management program for improving their health. Family members can play critical roles in the healthcare team, involving family in the care of elderly with disabilities can improve care process, patient self-management, and patient outcomes. Diet significantly influences the development of coronary heart disease, and several epidemiological studies have taken up in investigating the role of dietary factors. quantity and quality of carbohydrates in diet have been documented to influence chronic conditions like obesity, coronary heart diseases, and hypertension. Modification of behavior such as stopping cigarette smoking, physical activity, and eating healthy all have a beneficial impact on major biological cardiovascular risk factors. Aged people should be strongly encouraged to reduce fast foods, carbonated drinks, total fat, saturated fat intake, and daily salt intake. Increasing physical activity level along with dietary modification can reduce development of cardiovascular diseases. Oral health. Oral health is one of the vital and a key factor of healthy aging. Poor oral health can negatively impact on general and well-being in aged people. Older adults who preserve their natural teeth are prone to dental caries. The growth of dental caries is affected by the regularity with which sugars are consumed, which at time increases in older people through the use of high energy snacks or supplements. In some older adults, the occurrence of pain while ingestion and chewing devoid of their natural teeth, stained or damaged teeth have a major impact on functional ability and their daily lives. Infection of the teeth or dental caries in elderly presents another physiological burden important for those whose systems are previously weakened by disease and aging. Gum disease or periorodontal diseases are infections of the supporting structures of the teeth. When not treated, periorodontal diseases can result in the loss of teeth. It is very difficult for older people with functional limitations to maintain good oral health. The root cause of dental caries is due to a progressive change of the organic medium of the enamel and a protrusion of microorganism into tooth substance. This results in consequent loss of mineral salts and is accounted for by the effect of acids resulting from the protein breakdown and mechanical breakdown following the loss of organic matrix. Elderly are required to visit a dentist for the most basic use of dental care services. For prevention, early detection, and treatment of oral health problem, caretakers need to see for an inclusive assessment of teeth, gums, and soft tissues. The use of fluoride protects against dental caries, and tooth brushing twice a day with fluoridated toothpaste is found to be associated with better oral health. Diabetes. Type 2 diabetes is a metabolic disorder associated with age and obesity, characterized by hyperglycemia and inadequate secretion or action of endogenous insulin. Among elderly, the prevalence of diabetes increases as the rate of metabolism slows down due to lessening lean body mass and escalating sedentary lifestyle. Globally, diabetes in older adults is affecting an increasing number of individuals. The prevalence of type 2 diabetes mellitus increases with age and reaches 25% in those older than age 65 years. In India, there are about 3.5 crore diabetic patients, and by 2025, this number will rise to about 5.2 crores. More than half of those suffering from diabetes are above 60 years of age. It is considered that the earliest defect in the pathogenesis of type 2 diabetes is impaired insulin action and insulin resistance. So, this will result in partial suppression of hepatic glucose output, impaired triglyceride uptake by fat, and impaired insulin-mediated glucose uptake in the periphery. Eventually, beta islet cells, pancreas, tends to increase the amount of insulin secreted to overcome the insulin resistance. Elevated insulin levels will overcome the impedance to the action of insulin, and state of high insulin level persists for many years. Thus, hyperglycemia and dyslipidemia occurs when there is a variance between insulin requirement as dictated by insulin resistance and insulin supply as dictated by beta cell function. Other risk factors associated with development of type 2 diabetes include physical inactivity, diet, increasing age, insulin resistance and ethnicity, family history of diabetes, hypertension, and dyslipidemia, genetic, environmental, and behavioral factors. The most common symptom of diabetes in older adults include weight loss, blurred vision, abnormal thirst, and frequent urination. Chronic symptoms include coronary heart disease, nephropathy leading to kidney failure, cerebrovascular disease, and autonomic neuropathy causing gastrointestinal genitourinary symptoms. Management and prevention of diabetes. Weight control, preventing obesity, and enhancing physical activity level is the most promising approach to prevent diabetes. Management and control of weight gain helps to improve glycemic level, reduces risk of coronary heart disease and hypertension, and thus can prevent the development of type 2 diabetes in those with pre-diabetes. It can be achieved by a healthy lifestyle, which includes a reduction in energy intake and an increase in physical activity. Dietary modification is crucial for diabetes prevention in aged people. Diet high in plant food is often associated with a lower incidence of diabetes mellitus. Older patients with hypertriglyceridemia may benefit from the addition of fish oil. Calcium and vitamin D supplementation is encouraged for bone maintenance and prevention of fractures, an increased complication that is seen in type 2 diabetes. Care should be taken to restrict the amount of sugar and refined cereals in the diet, and one should include whole grain cereals and legumes, pulses, fiber-rich fruits and vegetables. Cerebrovascular disease. Stroke is the rapidly developing functional loss and disturbance of cerebral ability or neurological impairment characterized by numbness, imbalance, weakness, visual loss, and language dysfunction. Strokes are more common in older people. Despite the fact that a person of any age can have a stroke, almost 3/4 of all strokes occur in people 65 years of age or over. Aged people who had stroke are at highest risk of death in the weeks after the event, and depending on type, severity, age, comorbidity, effectiveness of treatment of complications, between 20-50% die within the first month of stroke. Risk factors for stroke can be classified as non-modifiable and modifiable. The modifiable risk factors are metabolic syndrome, such as obesity, high blood cholesterol, elevated blood pressure, and behavioral factors, such as stress, physical inactivity, tobacco smoking, and alcohol consumption. Non-modifiable risk factors are increasing age, heredity, and gender. People who have had a stroke may have trouble with many activities that were easy before, such as walking, talking, and taking care of activities of daily living. And some patients may be left with no disability or with mild, moderate, or severe disability. Ischemic stroke is caused by arterial occlusion, that is, when blood supply to a part of the brain is suddenly interrupted. Ischemic cerebrovascular disease is mainly caused by thrombosis and embolism. Cerebral thrombotic infarction results from the atherosclerotic obstruction of large cervical and cerebral arteries, such as proximal and intracranial vertebral arteries, with ischemia in all or part of the territory of the occluded artery. This can be due to blockage at the site of the main atherosclerotic lesion or the embolism from this site to more distal cerebral arteries. Embolic cerebral infarction refers generally to a blood clot in the cerebral arteries coming from other parts of the circulatory systems. After therapy and recovery from stroke, the patient should be given proper attention and personal care, such as bathing, dressing, coordinate healthcare needs, such as medications, and participation in stroke rehabilitation. First and foremost thing is to prevent another stroke. Having a stroke puts survivors at high risk for another stroke. Rehabilitation is a must for such patients because it helps the person keep abilities and gain back lost abilities to become more independent. It usually begins while the patient is still in acute care. Family members should be supportive and allow survivors to do things for themselves. They should support the patient's effort to participate in rehabilitation decisions. Regular physical therapy or counseling, providing eating healthy food, getting enough rest may help the survivor maintain and increase his or her ability to function. Osteoarthritis. Osteoarthritis is the most common musculoskeletal condition, is the thinning of the cartilage characterized by progressive loss of articular cartilage and osteophyte formation. It most commonly affects the joints in the knee, hands, feet, and spine, and is also relatively common in other joints such as the shoulder and hip joints. It is a global health burden and a long-term chronic disease involving the thinning of cartilage in joints, which results in bone rubbing together, creating stiffness, pain, and impaired movement. Frequency of osteoarthritis is increasing and will persist to do so as the population increases and ages. In elderly, it is considered to be a major cause of disability. Significant bone loss generally begins to occur at around 50 years of age in women and 65 years of age in men. Aging is associated with a loss of bone and total body calcium. Older people are at increasing risk of developing osteoporosis, hip and wrist fractures, spinal and compression fractures as they age. Osteoarthritis is described by the breakdown of cartilage in joints, often followed by stiffness and pain. Due to deterioration of the organic matrix of the cartilage, the bones of the joint begin to run against one another, causing pain and locomotor disabilities. Later, osteophytes may be developed, thereby causing additional pain and weakening of the surrounding tissues. Prevention and management. Exercise is advisable for elderly with osteoarthritis for strengthening local muscles and bones. Exercise reduces falls as occurrence of fall increases in older individuals, according to the most recent studies. In elderly, increased body weight is a key risk factor for osteoarthritis. Studies documented that weight loss significantly reduces knee pain and reduces inflammatory markers with associated improvements in mobility. Lifestyle modification and nutrition is of particularly important in elderly. Awareness is a must for prevention of fall and fracture in older adults. This can be accomplished by intervention programs such as fall prevention, proper nutrition, mobility, and exercise. Now, geriatric care in India. Traditionally, in Indian societies, when joint family system was the norm, elderly citizens were well looked after and provided with nursing care. The strength and social security of the elderly people were rested in the hands of younger generation of the family. Both young and old folks combined their wisdom to strengthen their family and altogether played a key role in socio-cultural heritage. However, due to rapid urbanization, as in other parts of the Western world, the family system and traditional values are changing, and rapid rise of nuclear family in place of joint family system. Due to shrinking family size and fewer caregiver, marginalization of the elderly within and outside families is on the rise. Keeping the above in mind, it is necessary to address and focus on the policy issues, programs, and strategies of developing human resources for health care of elderly in India. National Council for Older Person. The National Council for Older Person has been established in 1999 under the Ministry of Social Justice and Empowerment, with the Minister of Social Justice and Empowerment in matter relating to the welfare of the aged. NCOP 1999 guaranteed to financial security, pension, concessions to elderly in all modes of travels, healthcare, shelter, establishment of old age homes, and compulsory health care in all public hospitals for elderly. The policy also highlighted to make available opportunities for development of the potential of the older persons, provide protection against abuse and exploitation, and provide services for an enhanced quality of life. The Maintenance and Welfare of Parents and Senior Citizens Act 2007. This act is imposed by respective state government of India so as to monitor changes in elderly care and maintaining In the light of increasing intergenerational gap, with the establishment of this act, parents in India could apply for maintenance from their children who is not minor financially. The act also provides maintenance of maximum of 10,000 rupees per month from their children in case of negligence. Old age home. Different types of old age home are running in our country. Some are run by government, some by non-governmental organizations, charitable trust and philanthropist. The first old age home is supposed to have been started in the early 18th century. Such services in our country are provided by different bodies such as non-governmental organization, charitable trusts and philanthropist. There were about 700 old age homes in India in the year 1998. Non-governmental organizations provide user-friendly, affordable services towards these elderly people. Some non-governmental organizations run old age homes and daycare centers where elderly are admitted for a definite monthly charge. The role of NGOs play a critical role to uphold the dignity and life of older persons. Now, we'll summarize what we have studied till now. Care and management of elderly have become more challenging due to the increasing number of the older adults worldwide. Elderly suffer from multiple chronic diseases on account of their declining physical ability and increasing susceptibility to diseases. With rapidly growing aging population, declining health and changing socioeconomic structures, there is an increasing need for dedicated and comprehensive healthcare facilities for elderly that can be provided by the joint efforts of government and non-government bodies. It is important to assess the type of care elderly require. All cannot be clubbed under one umbrella. The elderly staying with family may still require day care in the form of recreational place to keep them involved. Others may require day care facilities when family members are not around. Others may require nursing assistance. Same is true of old age homes. It is important to provide support for health insurance services, disease and injury prevention for promotion of elderly health. The existing healthcare system in India is inadequate enough to provide the diverse needs for senior citizens. So, there is an urgent need to provide geriatric healthcare services and different approaches and interventions to address these issues. Thank you.